Hey, boys and girls, without further ado, got a super movie that we want to show you. Throw me a trash bag if you will. We got a couple of hours to kill. All in all, boys and girls, let's see. Michael's Monsters and Geeks. McCarran and Brackers want a party. 10 o'clock, don't be tardy. Hey, Alfonso.
Hey, Alfonso.
Junkyard John.
Junkyard John.
Somebody tell me who the hell rewrote this song.
I did.
Caught.
Just getting our sound Ooh. Levels right.
Yeah.
Oh, testies, well, anyway. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
No. We need that for later. Hi, kids. Welcome to this week's edition of Dumpsterpiece Theater, coming at you live and unrehearsed here at TV 38.
You know it.
Cable 35 in the Cantaloupe Valley, Lancaster, Plumdale area. Welcome to our 107th show. Getting close to our second year anniversary. Going
only
on to
seems
our third
like about
year.
85.
Isn't that scary? That's real scary.
Yeah, I'm already tired of it.
Yeah, I know I am. Anyway, for those of you, if you're just joining us and stuff, you're not familiar with the show. Oh, yeah, let's get the, what's tonight's bomb? Let's get that out of the way.
Oh. I know what it is.
Oh,
I know what it is.
Don't tell.
Somebody locked the damn thing. It's a locking
it's
bomb.
It's a monster movie.
Huh?
You told.
Oh, it's the monster from Piedras Blancas. Yeah, there we go. I'm sorry. The monster from Piedras Blancas, or of Piedras Blancas, I should say. A tasty little terror tidbit from 1959, directed by Irv Beswick and starring, Don Sullivan.
Let me say it.
Who?
It stars 50% Les Tremayne.
Ooh, we're doing a little bit of a Les
All
Tremayne
this
thing.
And Les Tremayne.
But it was Stu, honest. Oh, gosh. There we go.
Yeah, Don
anyway,
Sullivan.
Yes.
Yeah, the guy goes,
Don Sullivan.
Children laugh.
No!
Well, unfortunately, Don
no,
Sullivan doesn't do any singing in
no,
this.
No. Please say it isn't so.
It isn't so. It's the same guy, but it's not the same movie. So.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I know. Alfonso's disappointed. He wanted to hear Don Sullivan sing some stupid song. But unfortunately, it's another movie. Giant Gila monster. No.
So he's not going to sing?
Actually. Huh?
So he's not going to sing?
No. And you're not either.
Instead, we have the beautiful Gene Carmen in this film.
Ooh, yes. Yes, indeed. And several other folks that we'll be telling you about, the producer, Jack Kerwin, was also one of the head makeup people in the Universal
head
in
makeup.
The 50s.
He said head makeup.
yeah, head makeup like this. Here.
Oh.
Yeah, I'll teach you. Use a pun on our show.
I'm not going to say a thing.
Anyway, we'll say hi to everybody, someone special too. Hi.
Hello.
And... birthdays today, guys. It's April 19th, 1996.
My birthday.
Yes. Today, believe it or not, Dr. Frankenfurter himself, Tim Curry. Where's my close-up? Somebody give me a close-up. Somebody, yeah, get...
Hey, I've got one.
Drop that damn thing and, forget it. Here we go. Yes, Tim Curry is 50 today, guys.
No.
Yes. Yeah, hard to believe. Dr. Frankenfurter is 50 years old as of today.
What a great picture.
Yes.
He's old
and also celebrating his 70th birthday, this guy right here, Don Adams. Remember him from Get Smart?
Nope.
Yes.
Would you
yes,
believe
you do.
I'm...
Not that guy. That's Gilligan. He's too old. But anyway, Don Adams turned 70 today. So, yes, happy birthday, Tim Curry. It's 50th birthday. And happy birthday, Don
birthday
Adams.
Trick.
His 70th. Whoa. Yeah, Get Smart is getting a little old, isn't he? But anyway, let's see. Oh, and we'd also like to say an early happy birthday to Jack Nicholson, who will be turning I don't know what April 22nd, which
He's
is
like
also
90 now.
Bill's birthday too. this is kind of like a semi-birthday party. We got all kinds of stuff, but I guess what we'll do is get into our first reel of previews and short subjects.
That sounds like a good idea.
Yeah, yes, but first of all, be the 13th caller, 272-5725, and we'll get you this Zong tape, a local band here that plays at the Hangin' Java quite a bit of the time. So yes, be the 13th caller at 272-5725 and win this wonderful cassette tape of Zong.
Don't they have the Journey to the Vortex tape.
Music for your bathroom.
Yes, music for your bathroom and anywhere else in the house, actually. So here we are. We're going to hit some trailers and snack bar trailers from the past.
We're going to go through those trailers like a Texas tornado.
Yeah. Open up your living room doors and windows and pretend like this is a drive-in movie. Kick back, you know, and send the kids to bed. No, they'll want to see this. Scary monster coming up pretty soon. Right now, let's roll some trailers and the first segment of Dumpsterpiece Theater.
Here we go!
We proudly present previews of our coming attraction. The beginning of the end for the human race. For what men first thought were meteors or the often ridiculed flying saucers are in reality the flaming vanguard of the invasion from Mars.
Looks like they're going to come out of that gully pretty soon. We'll have to rush our defenses to be ready when they do.
We're going to need plenty of reinforcements.
We'll get them. Lieutenant, look!
They slash across country like scythes, wiping out everything that's trying to get away from them.
That explains why communication is cut the moment their machines begin moving.
Montreal's blacked out. Nothing more has come through.
Same thing that happened on the Pacific coast. Anything from them yet?
No, Mr. Secretary. We've had nothing from San Francisco for over 5 hours.
The nations of the world mobilize their armed might, rushing to defend the Earth against the unknown weapons of the super race from the Red Planet. Is there nothing that can stop the Martian death machines?
Guns, tanks, bombs, they're like toys against them.
We know now that we can't beat their machines. We've got to beat them.
All over the world, human beings cower before the onslaught of these unearthly enemies, whom no one has ever seen. Panic that sweeps around the globe as the great masses of mankind flee blindly in a headlong stampede of hysteria.
In the stars is a message of doom for this, our world. And now, in the most shattering experience the screen has ever given you, Paramount tells what could happen within your lifetime when worlds collide. An astronomer checks and double-checks his horrifying discovery. A distant star racing through space toward an inevitable collision with this planet. The United Nations meet in emergency session. All conflicts pale before this threat from another world.
If you wait until the danger is visible to the naked eye, it will be too late to escape.
High on a mountaintop, an army of scientists work desperately to build this giant rocket, this modern Noah's Ark to carry a few picked survivors of our doomed civilization to a new life on another world, reaching the heights of self-sacrifice, the depths of the animal lust for survival as they fight to be among the few who can be saved.
Let's take the ship away from them! Come on!
Fighting among themselves, fighting against time, as doomsday is upon them.
I think all you scientists are crackpots. Nothing is going to happen.
When worlds collide, you'll see the most amazing, awe-inspiring scenes ever put on film. the forces of nature unleashed in all their terrifying force. Tremendous tidal waves smashing New York City. The molten fires from the bowels of the earth gushing out to consume our world.
Circumstances, or to magnify one of them in size and strength, took it out of its primitive world and turned it loose in ours. Then expect something that's fiercer, more cruel and deadly than anything that ever walked the earth.
Even science was stunned. The new atomic miracle should have been mankind's greatest boon. Instead, when such power to cause phenomenal growth proved dangerously unstable, man was confronted with his most shocking blunder.
The isotope triggered our nutrient into a nightmare.
A blunder that transformed a tiny insect into the 100-foot spider that was now ravaging the panic-stricken countryside.
BC.
To reach this lost civilization, science had followed a trail through burning desert sands, through the roaring avalanches of Mount Puitara, and finally, deep into the bowels of the earth. Not even history had recorded the existence of this unknown empire of darkness.
There is no world beyond ours.
If I ever get out of here, into my world.
The world of lights and flowers?
Will you come with me?
Never before had outsiders beheld such sights. The sacred ritual of the sun death. The blazing sacrificial chambers. The court of the all-powerful high priest of Ishtar.
You will die in the fire of Ishtar.
The blood-lusting mole people storming from their subterranean caverns.
It's coming. Here it comes. It's intermission time. Time to visit our concession stand. Show starts in 10 minutes. Thank you.
happy to have you with us this evening and want you to enjoy every minute of your stay here. And while you relax and stretch, visit our concession where you'll find something to please you. There are ice-cold drinks, delicious sandwiches, ice cream, coffee and snacks, and many other pleasing treats. Our foods are fresh and tasty, our drinks satisfying and refreshing. They're so good. Starts in 9 minutes. Crispy, crunchy, hot buttered popcorn. Really good. Tender, tasty hamburgers with all the trimmings.
Gentlemen, save your battery and your disposition. When it rains, you can still enjoy the movie with a Drizzle Guard rain visor. Simply press suction cups to the windshield as shown in the detail on your instruction sheet. Drizzle Guards are on sale now at the concession stand, and remember, they are reusable.
Show starts in 8 minutes.
Hungry? How about a hearty Castleberry's Pit Cook barbecue sandwich? Castleberry's has the smoky, savory goodness you get only with the finest lean chunks of meat, slow cooked over a real barbecue pit to seal in the succulent juices, and braised with a zesty barbecue sauce. No wonder Castleberry's Pit Cook barbecue sandwiches have such a luscious flavor. Great with soft drinks, French fries, and other fine snacks. Visit our snack bar now and ask for Castleberry's Pit Cook barbecue sandwiches.
Show starts in 7 minutes. First crunching, refreshing, ice-cold drink. Starts in 6 minutes.
Thank you.
in 5 minutes.
Men, there's a drive-in movie full of juicy people. Wow!
It's a trap! Oh, help! It's Pick! We've had it, men.
A pleasant aroma for you, but not for mosquitoes. Pick is easy to use. Light it and forget it. Pick's aroma keeps mosquitoes, gnats, and sandflies away. Pick is the best protection for barbecues, fishing and camping trips, or just relaxing in the yard.
So if you don't want our company ever anywhere, just light Pick and see what I mean? Bye!
Pick is on sale at the refreshment stand now. Folks, it's really delicious, and we know you'll enjoy it, too. At our refreshment stand, you'll find these pizza pies, freshly baked to your order. Make sure you get yours and enjoy it now.
Show starts in 4 minutes.
Visit our concession and see for yourself the delicious treats, drinks, and snacks awaiting you. If you are thirsty, try ice-cold soft drinks or a cup of hot, flavorful coffee. Get something to go with it, like a sizzling and satisfying hot dog or a tasty, tender sandwich. Try one of these delicious treats, and you'll be back at the concession for more before the show is over. The service at our concession is friendly and efficient.
Show starts in 3 minutes. Crispy, crunchy, melt-in-your-mouth popcorn. Fresh brewed hot coffee, as you like it.
Yes, sir. May I help you?
I'd like two of those, please.
Hot dogs? Yes, sir.
And three of those, and one of those, and five bars of these, and a cup of that nice hot liquid.
Coffee. Coming right up.
Oh, and two bags of those peculiar white coffee material.
You mean our crunchy popcorn. Shall I wrap that for you, sir?
Oh, that's all right. My saucer just outside.
They come from miles to enjoy our intermission.
Show starts in 2 minutes.
Symbols. We're all familiar with them. There are shortcuts to vital information. That's why, to familiarize you with the movie rating symbols which will be used by this theater, we present the following guide for parents and young people. It is designed to inform parents about the suitability of movie content for viewing by their children. G, all ages admitted, general audiences. GP, all ages admitted, parental guidance suggested. R, restricted, under 17 requires accompanying parent or adult guardian. X, no one under 17 admitted.
Sizzling hot dogs, bursting with juicy goodness. Show starts in 1 minute.
Thank you.
along with the show.
Well, hi, welcome back. When they say on with the show, it just means us, kids. Sorry, it's real change time. We're going to have a few things. We got a nice letter on the email from my good friend Carla Tipton, whom I used to work with at the Antelope Valley Press. She's a wonderful person. She goes, "Hi, John. I found this page through the Lycos and just wanted to say hi. Wish I could get the show out in Rosemond." Oh, man, you and me both. We're trying to get out there. Am I really the 0000001th person to see your webpage?
Yes.
Ooh, I don't know. How about that? Oh, he says yes. Keep in touch, Carla. Well, yes, indeed. That was printed for Dump TV by Alfonso and the Princess.
Don't you eat it?
All right. Well, thanks, Carla. It was nice to hear from you again. And yeah,
why don't they get us in Rosemond?
It was a lot of fun. And, let's see.
Yeah, how come they don't get us in Rosemond, Junkyard John?
What was that?
They
don't have
us.
All right. Anyway, we'll get back to some less serious stuff. We're going to get to the monster of Piedras Blancas. There's what the guy looks like. Yeah, let's not get a too close look at him yet. We want to surprise you. So here's reel number one of the monster of Piedras Blancas on Dumpsterpiece Theater.
Monster of
Be ready to scream.
Constable? I don't know what to think. They're white as sheets. They don't look like they got a drop of blood left in them. We'll know better after an autopsy.
I bet old Sturgis knows more than he'll tell. The Rinaldi brothers always fished out at the point.
The boat could have drifted back.
How about it, Madsen? I suppose you let me do the thinking. You take these bodies over to Kolchak's and I'll have Doc Jorgensen take a look at them.
I still think Sturgis ought to tell us what he knows.
Maybe he don't know nothing.
You want to bet?
Oh. All right, now quit your grumbling. Get him out of here. Okay, folks, you go on home now, will you? This is not a Roman holiday, please.
I need some supplies.
Do you see what happened to the Rinaldi brothers?
I didn't stop.
It was me that found them. I went out on the pier to look at my lobster traps when I see the boat way out over there by the breaker line. Well, it was low in the water and looked like it was empty. But I did not pay much attention until it drifted near the pier. Then I seen them, like slaughtered steers. Their throats cut clean. Funny thing, though, not much blood around.
That lens cleaner I ordered come in yet?
That'll be in next week. You know, the constable has the idea that they got caught in that squall we had last night and couldn't keep off the rocks. But if that was the case, I say they would still be on the rocks and nothing left of that boat at all.
Let me have a pound of liver and two of bacon.
You want to know what I think? It ain't rocks and it ain't squalls. It's something living that did it.
Coach had to talk too much.
That's what they said 2 years ago when that couple came down from the east to go fishing. They found nothing else but some debris washed up on the shore. Anything else?
Just my week's meat scraps.
There's 13.50. You know, if this had happened when I first came here, there would be nobody said nothing about rocks and squalls. It would be the monster of Piedras Blancas. I'm not so sure they would not be right. You know, we should pay more attention to these legends. It would explain many things that happened in the last 30 years.
Kolchak, you're a bigger fool than I thought. Now, where's my meat scraps?
You did not show up yesterday, so I gave them to Burke. for his horse.
You knew I'd be in.
I'm getting tired of keeping these meat scraps for you. Besides, Bert paid for it.
You idiot. You'll be sorry for this.
That'll be $3.
Where do we put them?
Wait a minute. Open up the ice room. Now, don't forget, we're burying the Rinaldi brothers in the morning. First-class funeral. Better not miss it.
What's biting him?
I didn't save the scraps for his stupid dog. I understand Doc Jorgensen's coming to look them over. I've got my own ideas of what happened. Come on.
Good morning, Dad.
You left early this morning, Lucille.
I had to open up.
I got the supplies, so you won't have to shop.
Thanks.
Be home before dark. I'll have supper ready.
Oh, I've got to work tonight, Dad. Mrs. Madsen isn't feeling too well.
Oh. You got some nice liver. You always like that.
I'm sorry. I can't help it.
I don't like you coming home after dark.
Oh, I'll be all right. That'll bring me.
Don't be late. Understand?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Sturgis, can I have a word with you? I thought maybe you might be able to help me. Now, I know the Rinaldi boys always fished out to the point, and I thought you might have seen them. What time did the squall hit out there last night?
About midnight.
What time did you start the foghorn?
I blew from 11:30 till dawn.
Uh-huh. Man, you didn't see anything unusual all night.
If I had, I'd tell you.
Just that I knew they always fished out there.
I've told them plenty of times. Dangerous this time of year. Never can tell when a blow's coming up. But they wouldn't listen. Nobody listens. They'll learn someday.
What's aching him?
He is the most unfriendly man I ever knew. Oh, I'm sorry, Lucy. I didn't mean that. This business has got me upset, I guess.
That's all right, Mr. Madsen. I know the town isn't very fond of Dad.
I'll go see what Doc's found out. I don't imagine there'll be many people in for lunch today, so take the afternoon off if you'd like. Eddie here can take care of things.
All right, I'll see.
All right.
Your dad and the town always been at odds with one another?
No, not always.
What happened? Don't want to tell me?
Some other time.
Hey, lady, you gonna let a customer die of thirst?
I don't know why I let this upset me.
Oh, it's natural.
Dad isn't really like that.
Look, I'm sure he isn't. Yeah, I've got a good idea.
What's that?
Well, I've got to go out to the point and pick some specimens. Why don't you come along?
Gee, I'd like to, but I haven't had a chance to clean this place all day.
You might not get another offer.
All right. Maybe the townspeople won't be hungry today, but I'll bet you will. I'll make some sandwiches and we'll take them with us.
There, you see, I knew there was some reason I wanted you to come along.
I'm not sure it's me or my cooking you're falling for.
Well, I always try to keep guessing.
Oh, you do, do you?
Well? What happened, Doc? What'd you find?
Well, the jugular veins, the carotid arteries, the esophagus, the trachea were cut straight across. There was a complete transection of the spinal cord. In short, the heads were severed from the trunks. Death was instantaneous.
Well, how could it have happened?
I don't know, George. If we were living in the 19th century, I'd say they were victims of the guillotine.
You mean they were murdered?
That's your department, not mine.
I thought maybe it was an accident.
Well, maybe it was. But I doubt it. The manner of death was identical in both cases, and it had all the earmarks of a conscious act.
Looks to me like the work of some inhuman beast.
Oh, that's a pack of nonsense, Kojak.
You haven't been here as long as I have, Constable. Have you not heard of the legend of the monster of Piedras Blancas?
An old wives' tale, you know it.
Yes, of course it is. Now, it may have been a freak accident, or we may have a lunatic on our hands. Have there been any reports of strangers in the vicinity, George?
No, I haven't heard of any. I can check with the constable over at Windswift. Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's go over to the office. Look, Kochek, the whole town's upset. Now, keep your stories to yourself until we get this cleared up.
Do you really think you will?
Let's try this.
Like a drugstore cowboy.
Flattery will get you nowhere.
I've noticed.
Oh, the townspeople don't know what they're missing.
Neither does Mr. Madden.
Well, it isn't going to bankrupt the wing.
Oh, I left a dollar in the till.
I feel like a kept man.
Don't you worry. I'll get it back several times over. Remember, you're taking me to the Wind Club Saturday night.
Oh, was that this Saturday night?
You know darn well it was.
Oh, that's right. Next Saturday night's Marjorie.
And the following Saturday, Imogene.
Imogene?
Kochek prize hosting.
Thank you very much. Now, can I have a pickle?
Help yourself. Fred, why did Mr. Madsen question Dad about the Rinaldi brothers?
Just a shot in the dark, I guess.
He couldn't think Dad had anything to do with it.
Well, I'll ask George, but I think he was just looking for a clue.
I guess so, but it worries me. I know the whole town's against Dad, and all he wants is just to be left alone.
Well, sometimes in a small town, that's asking too much. Oh, I gotta get going or I'll never get any specimens.
Oh, I love it here. I wish I never had to go back to town.
No, no, back in the house, Ring. Go on, get in there now. I haven't got one thing to go on except two mangled corpses and a busted-up book.
I wish I could say I thought it was an accident, George, so you could close the books, but it just doesn't add up. You know, there was something I didn't mention to you in front of Kochek.
Oh, what was that?
Do you remember when I told you that the heads were severed from the trunks, almost as if by a surgeon's scalpel?
Yeah.
And yet the main arteries were distended several inches. It appeared as if something had been attached to pump out the blood.
I don't understand what you mean, Sam.
Generally, when a person is killed, the heart stops pumping almost immediately. There's always some blood left in the body.
You mean that there wasn't any blood left in him?
Essentially none.
Sam, you don't think we got a monster on our hands now, do you?
No, I don't. I think that there's a logical explanation that we just haven't found yet. But if I were you, I'd ride herd on Kochek.
Which is where I met.
Rumors won't help now.
With Esther Williams.
And it
take my advice. You lock the doors and stay in the house tonight. Oh, thanks, Mrs. Wilson. Don't forget what I said. What can I do for you, Constable?
You can do what I ask you to.
I was only telling Mrs. Wilson what I thought.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the trouble with you. You're always telling people what you think.
No crime in that.
In the past, no, maybe not. This time you got the whole town upset.
They got reason to be.
Oh, about the Rinaldi brothers, yes, but not about some monster.
You know as well as I do, those two are not murdered by any ordinary human.
I didn't say anything about murder.
You giving out that bunk about an accident?
Until I'm sure, that's the official theory. You better remember.
Any two-year-old can tell there was no accident. You should look up the history of this village.
Look, Kochek, I'm not going to argue with you. Now, I'm ordering you to stop the rumors. And if you don't stop spreading them, come on, I'm going to lock you up for attempting to incite riot.
You can't do that.
You try me. People don't mind their own business.
Who, Kochek?
Yeah. He's got the whole town in a state of nerves.
He's a great talker.
I told him if he didn't quit it, I was going to have him thrown in jail.
Oh, you can't do that.
Oh, I know that, but I don't think he does. Come inside for a minute, will you, Fred? I want to talk to you. Come on, have a cup of coffee.
That Kochek's an idiot. He'd spend half as much time tending the business as he does gossiping, we'd be better off. I ordered that cleaner a month ago. Next week, he says. I'll bet we don't get it this time next month. See why they can't leave us alone.
We do our job. There hasn't been a wreck on this point since we've been here.
Those two brothers go fishing. Next thing, people asking questions, prying into our business. They got to keep away from the point. That's what the wife's here for. That girl wouldn't work nights. A lonely place to get to after dark. Come on, Ray. Come on, boy.
I'd invite you in, but it would only upset Dad.
He's going to have to get to know me sometime.
Let him get used to the idea of us growing together first.
Has he always been like that?
When I was a child, he was lots of fun.
What happened?
I remember it was just before my ninth birthday. Mother hadn't been feeling too well that afternoon. There was a ship in trouble off the coast, and Daddy had to stay in the tower. Mother got worse, but wouldn't let me call him until early morning. He phoned for the doctor, but he refused to come out in the storm. When they returned, Mother was dead.
I'm sorry.
They were so much in love. When Daddy was first transferred here, he wouldn't have anything to do with anybody. Shortly after, I was sent away to boarding school. It's just been in the last 2 years that I've even been home during summer vacation.
He must be a very lonely man.
He is. He lives in a world all of his own. Sometimes I can't even get through to him.
How's he going to take me?
All right, I think. But it's going to be slow.
Well, we've got the rest of the summer.
It's a beautiful night.
It's almost too nice.
I haven't got a parlor I can invite you into, but I've got the best beach and rocks on the coast. Let's take a walk.
I'd love to, but if I don't get those specimens prepared I collected this afternoon, our trip will have been for nothing.
Well, you're very flattering.
I'm sorry. Now, you know I didn't mean it that way.
I forgive you. I'll be all right. See you tomorrow.
Night.
I'm sorry.
Night ready to drive up a while back?
Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful night.
You've been swimming. How many times have I told you not to go swimming on that beach at night alone?
Daddy, you wouldn't have wanted me to swim with anybody. I forgot my suit.
I don't know what they teach you in college these days, but it certainly isn't modesty.
Independence, Daddy. Independence.
All the same, this is a wild and desolate coast. There's no place for a young lady, boy, or anyone else, for that matter, to be out alone at night.
All right. I won't do it again. Tonight I had the strangest idea that I had a visitor.
What do you mean?
Nothing, really, I guess. I just had the feeling that somebody was watching me.
Again at night, and I'm going to ship you back to that fine school
of yours before vacation's over. Oh, Daddy, you're not serious. Yes, you bet I am. You're very angry. Let me
get to bed. It's getting late.
I'm sorry, Dad.
Good night. Thank you.
come to the cemetery. Okay, Mom.
Brothers to rest with this promise that their untimely end shall not go unaccounted for as we put them to rest in the good earth of their native village. I shall read these words, for they were men who lived and died by the sea. O most powerful and glorious Lord God, at whose command the winds blow, lift up the waves of the...
Here we are, Dumpsterpiece Theater, TV 38, Cable 35, coming at you live from the Cantaloupe Valley. There we go, that takes care of the FCC. And Stu's in the background. Whoa, it's a little hot out here. Anyway, we're getting set up. We've got a special treat for you.
Is it tasty?
Well, yes, I hope so. It's very tasty, actually. In June of 1990, I had the pleasure of interviewing the star, Les Tremayne, at the Pacific Pioneer Broadcasters Studios in Hollywood. And what we're going to do is we're going to cue up this interview and just let you hear some of Les's reflections on that show. Here we go.
Irv Berwick and Jack Keevan were the producers. Irv had been a dialogue director at Universal, which is where I met him, doing something, I think it was with Esther Williams. Jack Keevan was a makeup man who later, he's very, very rich now, thank goodness, he opened up his own makeup business and got along beautifully with it. I haven't seen him for years. Irv I see quite often. His son was in the picture, and his son, he had polio as a little teeny baby. And he has a limp, but he is now a director.
Wow.
And he and a friend of his came to me not long ago and asked me to do a gag scene for them in a film they were shooting. It was awful. But well, you do these things was for your friends
a,
for
was
fun.
Was that Attack of the B Movie Monsters, perhaps? Or
could be. I don't know.
I'll be.
I don't know. But General Mann was in it, if that was the picture. Irv and Jack were just great to work with, and we did that up at Point Conception, I believe it was, outside of Lompoc, at the White House there.
Well.
And we had a lot of fun.
It looks like it's a low-budget picture. There's really, a lot of people say, oh gosh, there's not much to recommend on it, but it's sincere. There were good performances for what it was, and the monster is quite memorable.
Yes, I think so. If you don't see his back, where, of course, the zipper was. The monster, I wish I knew the man's name. He was a young man, youngish man, and he had broken his back. He was a stuntman.
Oh.
And he was mending when we did the picture. But he couldn't get out of bed, you know. And he mended himself in a way, because he would get out of bed and try to walk and collapse and then pull himself up by the bedpost and try it again until he finally got on his feet. At least that's what he told us. I had 3 broken ribs while I was on that picture. Not from that picture. I did a thing called the Gray Ghost and had an accident in that. And I was driving a 300 SL Mercedes Benz at that time. You know, one of those. And I had to shift gears, and it was a little rough.
Been a little tough.
3 broken ribs. And in getting to the scenes, the sets, we drove to the lighthouse over some very rough terrain. And I will never forget how the pain I was in on those rides, because the ribs hadn't had a chance to heal, you know.
Wow, it doesn't show in the performance at all. You can overcome your...
It's a strange thing that happens to actors. You go above and beyond your personal life while you're doing something. And then afterwards you suffer for it a little, for a little more, you know. But I enjoyed doing the monster of Piedras Blancas. That was a fun picture.
It was an interesting little thing.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that little bit of film history. That is the very first time I have released that interview of Les Tremayne. Actually, that was part of maybe an hour and a half interview where we talked about films that he was in, such as War of the Worlds, The Monolith Monsters, The Slime People. So, so it was just a nice little segment. So what we're going to do is we're going to cue the tape back up and just get back to the movie. But first, we have an Alfonso magnet, a brand new manufactured Alfonso magnet to give away. Look at that. Isn't that a beaut? Yeah, Dean did a
valuable
hot job on that one. Anyway, be the 13th caller at 272-5725 and win the Alfonso magnet.
It's made from special materials that only special effects guys can get.
Yes, indeed. Special resin, so that. And before we go back to the movie, a postcard right quick. We got a postcard from Denise Lee, Mark, and Shantae and Fred. Denise won the bus last week, so Denise was on our show, and they sent us a postcard that says, could you show the movie Reefer Madness? Well, maybe. We're looking into that. Reefer Madness. No, we got rid of that soundboard. Or Atomic Cafe. Well, Atomic Cafe is owned, so we can't do that. But we'll look into Madness. We're dedicated fans of Dumpsterpiece Theater and KPAL 35. Well, thank you very, very much.
Well, the first part.
We'll try to get that to us in the next 2 or 3 weeks here.
We're big fans of yours.
Yes, so anyway. Oh, there's going to be a yard sale over the weekend at 41034 15th Street West, my friend Sid. So if you get a chance, head out there. That's 41034.
Is Nancy going to be there?
Between Avenue N and N4. What's that?
I said, is Nancy going to be there?
Oh, I don't know. Ooh, that was a bad one.
Thank you.
Anyway, let's get back to the movie here, A Monster of Piedras Blancas on Dumpsterpiece Theater. Loads of fun. I hope you're having fun with this film. Nasty monster, huh? You're going to see some fun
stuff.
What'd
the monster do with that girl's underwear anyway?
Oh, I don't know. I hesitate to think, Stu. Whoa.
We lay these brothers to rest with this promise that their untimely end shall not go unaccounted for. As we put them to rest in the good earth of their native village, I shall read these words, for they were men who lived and died by the sea. O most powerful and glorious Lord God, at whose command the winds blow, lift up the waves of the...
Maynard! Mom! Someone's been murdered! Mom! Someone's been murdered!
Who is it, Jimmy?
Mr. Kochek. He's dead. He looks awful.
Where, son? Where?
I went to his store to buy some candy, and he was in his office dead. And Mom, he didn't have any head.
Can you hold him here for a few minutes while I get back to town?
Yeah, sure.
All right, come on, Ed. Here, let's go.
We're not through here yet, folks. Let us repeat the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven.
Oh, this is no place for women and children. I'll send them home. Come on, please. Go on.
As soon as the doctor's looked at the body, we'll give you a report. Go ahead now.
How did it happen?
but I have a look.
Oh, Eddie, you better get outside and get yourself some fresh air so you feel better.
Okay.
Jimmy had to see a thing like this.
Is that code check?
Yeah.
Same way?
Complete transection of all the veins and arteries, plus the esophagus, the trachea, and the spinal cord. I couldn't have done a cleaner job myself.
And no blood again. That?
Pump dry.
All right, that does it. Now let's have a look around and see what we can find. They must have been killed last night or early this morning. Hello. This blob of ink here is completely dry. Now, I'd say that much ink wouldn't dry in less than 4 hours, Doc. What do you think?
Yeah, I'd say 4 hours would be minimum.
Yeah. I drove by here about 10:30 last night. The door was open. So I stopped in to see if everything was all right. Kochek said he had to work late. It was hot in here, and he left the door open to get some air. It must have happened between 10:30 and 4 this morning.
Mm. Well, it's difficult to tell with a body in that condition. I'd say about 1 or 2 a.m.
Yeah, well, I'll settle with that. Fred, did you find anything?
No, nothing yet.
Fred, come here a minute. What do you make of this?
I don't know. It looks like a fish gill, but it's too big.
Well, maybe something you picked up on the beach.
Could be. But I've never seen anything like it before.
Well, let's take it over to my office. We can run some tests on it and look at it under the microscope, hmm?
Might as well.
There doesn't seem to be anything else around here. Let's go.
You all right?
Yeah.
Take the body in the ice room, Eddie. Lock the place up. Stay here and keep an eye on things. I'll send the relief over there.
Sure. Did you find anything? Maybe it was for sex monster.
Now, none of that. We got enough trouble where it is.
You two scientists have been dipping that thing in the solution for the last hour. Looking at it this way and that, now what is it?
Our good constable doesn't seem to realize that scientific investigation is a slow and tedious process. Huh?
Sometimes taking years.
Oh, fine. We haven't even got days.
Oh, relax, George. I'll be through here in a minute. Fred, hand me that comparative slide, hmm?
The two structures are similar.
What similar?
Well, the structure of the specimen we found in Kochek's store is essentially the same as that of the diplovertebron, only larger.
What is a diplovertebron?
It's a prehistoric amphibious reptile thought to be extinct. Fossilized specimens have been found about 100 miles north of here.
But this is living tissue. Living tissue? I thought you said they were extinct.
This is not the scale of a diplovertebron. I simply said they were similar.
Well, what is it then?
I wish we knew that and how it got into Kochek's store.
Oh, well, he's always roaming up the coast fishing. It's probably something he found and brought home with him.
Well, maybe, but I still want to run a few more tests on this.
Yeah. I think so.
And in the meantime, I'm no closer to solving my problem.
Well, that's about it until we can make positive identification one way or another. Even then, it may not help.
I can't do any good here. I might as well get back to the cafe.
Mr. Martin, I've been looking all over for you.
What's the matter, Lucy?
Dad.
What happened?
I don't know exactly. I found him at the bottom of one of the caves. He's hurt, I can tell. He's unconscious.
Now, just take it easy. We'll go right out. Here, Lucy, here. Take one of these. You'll feel better in a minute.
Can you make it?
All right, let's get going.
Lucy, you stay here. Doctor. Has a bad gash in his right arm and his leg hurts. I can't tell how badly until I examine him more carefully. Help me get him to his feet, huh? Be careful, that arm is hurting real bad. That's it. Now, George, you get my bag, will you, please? Let's get him to the layout so I can give him a more thorough examination.
Fine girl, Fred.
Yeah, I know.
Doc, how is he?
No, he's had a bad fall, but he's the wiry type.
Doctor?
No, later, Lucy, thank you.
Will he be all right?
No, he'll need rest. Take some time for this arm to heal, and he'll have to be careful no infection sets in.
What about his leg?
Well, fortunately, it isn't broken. Just a sprain, a bad cut. And I'll tape it up.
Thank goodness.
Honey, do you have any idea how this might have happened?
Nothing more than I told you. I went to bed about 11. I thought I heard him go out, but I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. Was he alone?
Probably Ring went with. That's strange.
What?
In all the excitement, I hadn't noticed. Ring hasn't been around all morning.
You know, I've never seen those two apart.
They never are, except when Dad goes into town. Then he locks him up. I'll call him.
Gone
to. He usually comes when I call him.
Oh, he'll show up. Lucy, here. Now, he'll probably sleep for quite a while. When he wakes up, give him one of these. If the pain is bad, one every 2 hours. Otherwise, one every 4 hours is often enough. Hmm?
Would you take him to my room, please?
Oh, sure. Boys, would you help him? I think he'll be more comfortable in bed. Hmm?
You bet.
Easy now.
All right.
Can he have something to eat when he wakes up, Doctor?
Yes, if he feels like it, but don't force him. Now, I'll be back later to have a look. And if there's any change, you can call, hmm?
Thank you.
I wish he had felt like talking. Maybe he'd been able to tell us something.
Well, it shouldn't be too hard to figure out, George. There was a broken lantern on the beach beside him.
Uh-huh.
Now, he must have gone out last night when Lucy heard him. He went down by the rocks and fell.
Yeah, but that still doesn't explain where the dog is. He's probably out in the moors chasing rabbits.
Well, maybe so.
Yeah, we better get back to town.
Yeah.
Look, take my Jeep. I'm going to stay with Lucy for a while. You can come back and pick me up later.
All right, Fred.
Perhaps you'll be able to talk then.
Thanks for everything.
Anytime, Lucy.
You look bushed. Sit down, I'll get you a cup.
I don't know how Dad's going to take this. He's never been sick a day in his life.
Well, he's just going to have to get used to it and take it easy for a while.
You don't know Dad and his lighthouse.
I'll come out and give you a hand. Maybe it'll give me a chance to get to know him a little better.
Lucy?
He's awake. How do you feel, Dad?
I don't know. What happened?
We found you on the beach at the bottom of one of the big cliffs. The doctor says you'll have to stay in bed.
But I can't.
You've got to.
I've got to turn the lights.
I'm sorry, sir. Those are orders.
What are you doing here?
He helped get you up from the beach.
Oh.
Would you like something to eat? Maybe some broth.
Well, I suppose you won't leave me alone until you get your own way.
It'll be good for you. Watch him, will you, Fred? I'll be right back.
Thank you.
Sorry. Do you have any idea what happened?
I'm trying to think.
Well, you must have gone out last night. Lucy said she heard you, and there was the broken lantern on the beach.
Yes, that's right. After she went to her room, I took the lantern and started down toward the cove.
Why?
She'd been swimming again, and I'd forbidden it. She's headstrong. Last night, she had the feeling she was being watched. I went down to see what I could find.
Did you see anyone?
No.
There's been another murder.
Who?
Kochek. We found his body this afternoon.
He talked too much.
Mr. Sturgis, you've been around a long time. What do you know of the legend?
Piedras Blancas? Well, the coastal currents off this point are very treacherous. And the rocks on the seaward side are covered white with gull droppings. Bad weather, almost impossible to see. Many a ship was lost on those rocks before this light was built. There's not a record of any survivors.
Oh, with a coast and surf like that, that isn't surprising.
No, but people would rather start a legend. Some of the earlier settlers claimed a monster lived in the rocks below this point.
You believe it?
Of course not.
Has anyone ever had a look in those caves?
Government land, nobody's allowed.
Do you mind if I have a look?
There's nothing there.
Well, then it won't hurt to have a look.
I don't want you on those rocks. It's dangerous.
All right. Are you sure that you don't remember anything that happened last night?
I did, I tell you.
To help us. You got to tell me whatever you can. Will, where was she going?
Let us send her to the store.
Thank you. Come on, let's go check with Eddie. See if she ever got there.
The broth will be ready in a minute. Well, what's the matter?
Well, nothing.
I can tell. Now, what is it?
Is your father off and gone from the lighthouse any length of time?
Why do you ask?
You said after your mother died that he changed.
Yes.
And that after you moved out here, you wanted to be left alone. He even sent you away to school and wouldn't let you come home during vacations.
What are you getting at?
How long was it after you moved here that he sent you away to school?
About 2 months.
Did anything unusual happen before he sent you away?
I don't think so.
But you said he seemed better for a while.
He was.
Then why did he send you away?
Oh, it was something I did. It wasn't anything, just kid stuff.
No, go on.
Well, when we lived up north, he let me play around the rocks and go to the beach alone. But shortly after we moved here, he refused me the privilege. So said it was too dangerous. The cliffs never seemed any bigger than the ones up north. So I sneaked away one day and got caught in one of the caves by the tides. When he found me, it was dark, and he was furious. I'd never seen him like that. He sent me to bed without supper, and the next morning I was packed off to boarding school. I didn't see him for almost 10 years.
And he didn't give you any reason at all?
I never questioned him.
You've heard of the legend White Rocks?
Sure.
But you've never been in those caves. I think I'll have a look.
What for?
Your father's keeping something from me.
Isn't that a little unfair?
I don't think so. He as much as ordered me not to go in those caves.
Well, this is his life. He's responsible.
Look, that's not quite the point. 3 people in the last 24 hours have met with violent death. I don't think there's anything to the legend, but I've got to be sure.
Even if it means disobeying my father?
I'm not his son-in-law yet.
I thought you trusted him.
I do.
If you did, you wouldn't go to the cave.
I'm sorry.
I don't think you'd better come here again.
To stay here till I said a relief. Let's look outside.
I can't understand where Eddie's disappeared to. You look in the office and see if Koshek's body's still there.
All right.
I'll try the ice room.
Yes.
Found our killer.
Or he's found us.
Well, can you handle things here? I better go get Fred.
All right, George. Now be careful.
Two more murders.
Oh, no. Who?
Eddie and Will's little girl.
How did it happen?
Well, I haven't got time to tell you now. I've got to get Fred and go back into town.
He went down to the cliff.
All right. Oh, look. Now, remember one thing. You keep the place locked and don't come out until we call you. Now, there's a creature loose around here someplace. He's not headed this way, but don't take any chances.
All right.
Now, remember.
All right.
Quite a fright. I'm sorry, Fred.
What's the matter?
We found our killer.
What is it?
It's inhuman. He's nearly 7 feet tall. He's got tremendous strength. You know that scale? That scale you found? That was part of it. He's killed 2 more people and escaped.
Where'd he go?
South, along the beach. We've got to track him down.
I'll tell Lucy.
No. I've already warned her. They're in no danger. We'll go after him.
hospital. Come on.
Daddy, do you want some broth? It's ready.
Men, wait. Now look, Fred and I will cover the beach along the rocks. Merritt, you take two men to cover the cliffs from the top. Jake, you try the moor. Now don't get divided. And don't try to take it by yourself because you're no match for him. Now fire three signal shots in case you come in contact with him. But don't get too close. Wait till the rest of us get there. You understand that?
Yeah.
All right, let's go.
Size of those
cliffs.
Want me to signal?
No. Let's wait till we're sure of these corners. So some of these caves come out on top of the cliff.
Oh, hey, welcome back to Dumpsterpiece Theater here, Cable 38, or no, Channel 38, Cable 35, rather. Well, I'm in the middle of the January 1990 edition of Film Facts Magazine that does a very, very good in-depth article on the movie we are watching tonight, The Monster of Piedras Blancas. This article and interview is by Ted Newsom. He interviews such people as Irv Beswick. Really nice little centerfold deal that he got there with the sequence you just shot, yeah.
Looks like a Vandals album cover.
Yeah, it does. Something that the Misfits would have done anyway. But anyway, you can get the back issues of Film Facts probably over at Eric Caden's Hollywood Book and Poster Store if you're ever in Hollywood.
That's Film Facts.
Or getting in touch with Film Facts Magazine. Very good article, very good magazine, and our buddy Jan Allen Henderson writes very frequently for it. Well, wasn't that fun? Yes, the monster got his first head, and in a nice way. I mean, I don't want to cat. Oh!
And there it is.
Yep. And of course, we had to keep track accordingly. Yes. And in honor of the head count stamp kit, we thought we'd give away a Judge Dredd stamper set. This is out.
You're gonna like this, boys and girls.
Yeah, I had to really like wrench this out of Alfonso's paws because he wanted this one himself. Oops, there we go. So be the 13th caller at 272-5725.
If you're a Stallone fan,
yes, watchful ink. Just add a drop of water on the stamp pad before use. Unfortunately,
yeah,
there's
check
no.
Check it out. It's got Mean Machine and Judge Dredd with his lawgiver.
Does it? Ooh, all right.
And it comes with a little pad of paper and a stamp pad, which you add a few drops of water. It makes a good case for carrying stuff in it.
Stuff, all right. Well, anyway, that's what we're giving away. So we'll be the 13 caller, 272-5725, win the Judge Dredd thing. And we're just going to run right back to the movie because we don't want to run out of
time. It's worth 99 cents.
Ooh. Here we are, reel number four of Monster of Piedras Blancas, classic 1959 horror shocker from Irv
Beswick. Don't go back yet.
Whoa. Hey,
don't go back yet.
We got it.
Did you know?
Oh, hold on a sec. Yeah, what?
Did you know that in this film that the monster's claws in this, the guy that made the costume is Jack Kevin, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, anyway, he also created the creature from the Black Lagoon and the mole people and the monster in This Island Earth.
Yes.
Which is going to be the MST movie, if you can catch it anywhere.
Yeah, I hope they play it here somewhere.
But anyway, the monster's claws are made of the mole people hands, and the feet are the Metaluna mutant feet. So
all right.
Look close.
All right, for once, Alfonso gets in on the information there. So, yeah, way to go, Alfonso.
I didn't even need my nose ray.
Yeah, all right. Well, yes, Kevin also produced this film and also, as Alfonso said, created the suit for it out of various things he did. Finally getting a little credit where credit is due.
Stuff found around the house.
Yes, indeed. So anyway, back to Les Tremayne, Don Sullivan, Forrest Lewis, and the rest of the cast. Wayne Beswick, actually, the little kid that was limping in the earlier part was the director's son. He actually had polio when he was a child. The limp was real. So just a little
and
bit
Don
of
Don Sullivan.
A little bit of background for you.
I
yeah,
not mentioned him.
Not Don
and
Sullivan.
Lord's head laugh, children laugh.
Here we go.
Lord's
head
laugh.
Yeah, get him.
Children laugh.
Back to the movie Lord's before he finishes the song. Oh, ho, ho.
Right away and patch him up.
We'll all have to go back. We'll need reinforcements.
Well, come on, let's go then. He needs many
contentions. Yeah, now look, Ben. We'll start the hunt tomorrow morning at daybreak. Bring Maris'
body, boys, will you? Let me help you. Glad
you're feeling better. You slept most of the day. This is getting warm.
I've got to get up to the light.
He says, we'll talk about it.
You don't understand.
Yes, I do. Yes, that's better. Dad, why didn't you want Fred to go to the cave?
It's dangerous.
Is that the only reason?
What's between you and Fred?
I'm in love with him.
I don't want you to see him again.
Two more people have been killed in the village. Do you know anything about the killing? The people in the village think you do.
They're fools.
Daddy, the last person killed was a child. A little girl.
Maybe I'm responsible. I don't know.
What do you mean?
Do you remember the long walks I used to take when we first came here?
You'd say they helped to keep you from brooding about Mother.
Yeah. Well, there were many caves along the cliffs that I was sure had never been explored. I noticed one in particular at low tide. One day when the tide was at full ebb, I waded out through the opening and walked through the... I walked for what seemed miles until I saw a light ahead. Climbed up to it and found a narrow fissure opening at the mouth of the big cave below the lighthouse. It wasn't big enough for me to get through, so I had to go back. Just before I got to the entrance, I realized the tide had closed me in. Suddenly, I had the strangest feeling that I was being watched. And I heard sounds like heavy breathing. I dove through the opening and swam out. The next day, I went back to the mouth of the cave below the light and left some fish I caught. The following morning, they were gone.
Is that why you packed me off to boarding school?
Oh, I knew it wouldn't be long until you'd find that opening and squeeze through. I couldn't take a chance, Lucy. After you left, I was even more lonely. But I got to worrying about that poor creature in the cave. I fished every day and left my catch. Finally, I just couldn't catch enough, so I got meat scraps. It wasn't long before the fish was refused, and I had to get more meat. And last night, when you mentioned that you had the feeling someone was watching you, go down and see. I must have slipped on the rocks or I don't know.
Sorry, Dad.
Can you remember anything else that happened last night?
I just had the feeling somebody was watching me, that's all. Dad, do you mean to tell me you've been feeding this whatever it is all these years?
Gave my scraps away the other day. I'd have paid him for them if that's what he wanted.
I'm good cipher.
So you see, if there is a monster, maybe in a way I am responsible.
Don't say that, Dad. You had no way of knowing.
But I should have guessed. I should have guessed and told the sheriff that. But somehow I had a protective feeling. Like it was my own. After you left, I was very lonesome, Lucy, and we left lonesome knowing that there was some living creature nearby. You know, it's stupid, but I never got along with the townspeople. It was something to hang on to.
I understand. Dr. Jorgensen says you'll have to stay in bed.
I've got to tend the light.
I'll turn it on when it's time.
But the prisms need cleaning, and it's got to be oiled.
One night won't hurt.
Lucy, you've got to help me.
It's going to be a clear night. You don't have to worry.
But suppose the legend is true.
You could kill yourself going up there tonight.
I could do less. I can't. It's my responsibility.
Oh, all right.
Lucy.
Let me get you something more.
You've got to help me. If a ship went aground tonight, and he was out there hunting, there wouldn't be a single survivor. Better bolt the door, windows. Now go. What's that for?
Is that nothing?
Look, Doc, can I give you a hand?
No, I'm almost finished now.
Oh, how bad is he?
Well, he'll be all right. Had a bad blow on the head. He's suffering from shock. Mashed hand. But I can't find much other damage.
Yeah. Look, I don't know what good all this snooping around does. Now that we got a monster on our hands, let's go out and get it.
You saw what happened this afternoon. We're no match for him yet.
All right. I'm sorry. I'm just jumping. Well, what did you find?
Definitely a member of the diplovertebron family. But a peculiar derivation.
Where'd he come from?
Well, from the description you and the doctor gave me, analysis of each book, I'd say was created at the bottom of the sea.
No, I don't understand it.
Well, it's obvious from the structure of this scale that he's capable of sustaining tremendous pressures, the likes of which you'd only find at great depths. Still, he seems equally capable of living out of water. This leads me to believe perhaps he's from a subterranean cave.
Oh, well, then you think he's some kind of a fish?
No. But he bears a marked resemblance to the reptilian family.
Like a crocodile, huh?
That's right. Of course, we have no idea where he came from or how he got there. But I'd say he's a mutation of the reptilian family. Well, this is what we've got to decide before we go after him in the morning. Does he have a brain that's capable of rational thinking, or is he just a beast? If he can think, we're in real trouble.
Okay, Mike. You take it easy for a while.
Thanks, Doc.
What do you think, Doc?
I think we'd better try to establish a pattern from his actions.
You abide the reptilian theory, then?
Oh, it accounts for the bloodlust, all right.
Oh, also explains his appearance.
Did you notice anything about his vision or hearing?
Not much. It all happened too fast. Offhand, I'd say he operates primarily on the sense of smell.
Why do you say that?
We didn't discover him until George surprised him by going into the ice room. Now, either he's very clever, knew we were there and was hiding, or else he didn't sense the danger until we were right on top of him.
Well, he might have been asleep.
If his sense of hearing was any good, he would have awakened long before that. I don't think he just happened to go into Kochek's store. I think he smelled the meat, went in, found Kochek, finished him off, and then went into the ice room in search of more food.
Yeah, and then poor Eddie walked right into the death trap.
That's right. Well, you think he either sensed or knew that if he remained there, he'd be fed? Then we have a thinking monster.
I'm afraid so.
I'd like to take him alive.
Why, we wouldn't stand a chance. Besides, I couldn't allow that. I'm responsible for the welfare of the people of this town. Now, we've got a monster on our hands, and it's my job to see it destroyed.
George, it may be the safest way to get him.
You're siding with him?
Now, look. It won't be easy to kill this thing even if we want to. You saw what happened to the meat cleaver when it hit him. Now, maybe we can kill him with a gun. I don't know. But I do know that our greatest advantage is our brains.
All right, then let's use them and not take a chance.
Listen to me a minute. We'll get a net and we'll put it at the base of the cliff with a side of beef in the middle of it. When he comes to get the meat, we drop the net and close in on him.
Believe me, George, it's the safest way. If you try to corner him, there's no telling how many men he will kill before you get him. Besides that, Fred is right. He may answer a lot of our questions on evolution, as well as putting our town on the map.
Well, I suppose you two will get your own way.
If I didn't believe it was right, I wouldn't even suggest it.
All right, then let's get into town. Now, I want to see that the streets are all cleared by dark. Then we'll go to the garage and get on this net business.
We'll see you later, Doc.
Call me if you need me. I'll be here.
Jake, Fred wants a rope net.
What for? Well, I've got an idea the safest way to catch the monster to trap it. Now, if we can get a net about 10 by 10, I think we can do it.
You got one?
I think so. We'll take a look.
All right, I'll be back shortly. I have to go over to the office.
Take the Jeep.
Oh, thanks.
This together.
What are you going to do with this thing if you do catch it?
Ship it to the university.
Well, what are they going to do with it?
Well, finding a living link in the evolution of any species could clear up a lot of unanswered questions.
I guess so, but it ain't getting this net though.
Fred, I'm worried.
What's the matter?
Well, as I drove over from the office, I noticed the light wasn't on. Now, you better phone Lucy and see if everything is all right.
Go ahead.
There's no answer.
right number?
761.
Try it again.
Something's wrong. I better get out there.
All right. You go ahead. Now, I'll round up some men, and I'll follow as quickly as I can.
I'll go with you.
You might hit the
light! Bright light!
Keep him in the light!
Lucy, turn on the light!
Leave the intermission thing.
Delicious. And it's sort of delicious.
Try some today. We are the Intermission Quartet.
Some quartet.
We sell refreshments at the Met.
At the Met?
So if you should want to get delicious
ice cream,
soft drink, popcorn,
candy. I like candy. It tastes good, dandy, and comes in handy when I fight the bull.
A popcorn puppy, so crisp and fluffy, we all eat popcorn until we're full.
Oh, how I love the soft drinks here. They taste as good as a lager beer.
And now our love forever ends. We'll have an intermission.
The two of you are beginning a strange journey, a journey that no Earth people have ever undertaken before.
Universal International presents the most startling, the most imaginative and suspenseful science fiction drama ever brought to the screen. You'll marvel at the superior intelligence that unleashes its deadly ray.
Dave!
Or can kidnap an airplane in flight.
Pulling us up.
Prisoners hurtling through endless space, speeding toward the unearthly furies of a planet gone mad. See sights never before dreamed by man. The battle between guided meteors and deadly rays.
They're gonna hit us! They're gonna hit us!
A planet doomed to destruction. While captive Earth people fight for their lives.
It is indeed typical that you Earth people refuse to believe in the superiority of any world but your own.
Run, Ruth, run!
It came from outer space to fill the world with terror, to bring you unforgettable suspense. What was it? Where did it come from? Who were the all-powerful creatures it brought from outer space? And what did they want on Earth? You can learn the amazing answer only when you see the most thrilling picture in years. It came from outer space. In the astonishing realism of three dimension, with objects coming right out of the screen, so real they almost touch you.
And he just did. Oh, well. Welcome back. That was the monster of Piedras Blancas here on Dumpsterpiece Theater.
It's oversized.
Yeah, we had lots of fun with it. Yes, yes,
seems
indeed.
Seems like it just started.
Yeah.
It seems like it's right. You see the scene?
Oh! Well, we thank you. You flatter us knowing with that one. Oh, yes. Anyway, we hope you enjoyed everything this evening. The rare interview with Les Tremayne. We'd also like to remind you one more time about the swap meet safari soiree out at the Shambhala Preserve out in Acton. That is on Soledad Canyon Road. When you get past that big bridge that's on Soledad Canyon Road that goes by this chasm, just keep an eye out. It's right down there, and you'll have a good time. It's only $7 for adults, $3 for kids, and it all goes to a worthy cause, preserving animal life on this planet, because we can't do it.
I can dig that.
Yeah, yeah, Alfonso's behind it 100%.
I want to buy a tiger.
Yeah, actually you can. You can sponsor tigers, and of course Ms. Hedren will be more than happy to fill you in on that. But for a certain
that's
fee per month.
Hedren.
Yes, that's yes, Tippi Hedren. You'll remember her from such classic motion pictures as The Birds and Marnie.
The Birds!
And she's also ventured into television a few times, and even quite recently, as early or as late as last year, I believe. So, yeah. Oh, oh, The Birds too. Oh, yeah, it was too. Yeah, stick to the original on that one, folks. Anyway, I don't know what we're going to show next week. We might kick around the idea and maybe show Reefer Madness. So we'll look into it and see how good our copy is. If you have any, yeah, my mic switched. Oh, there we go.
What about the puppets?
We were whispering. That's why you couldn't hear us.
Oh, okay.
We're just
that's
talking
it.
Amongst ourselves. Pay attention to
oh,
her.
Yes. Anyway, if you have any whatever. Ideas about what
yeah.
you'd like to see on Dumpster
Piece
Theater
desk.
As far as old classic movies from the 50s and 60s, roughly. Some 40s and 30s if you go for that, too. But give us a call at the Dumpster Piece Theater hotline. That's 947-4992. And say you want to see something like, oh, The Ape with Boris Karloff.
Or say
Dick
you don't.
Tracy meets Gruesome. Or what else do we have in the old grad
say,
bag?
Say Get Rid of the Carrot.
Get Rid of the Carrot. Oh, what?
It's nothing personal, dude. I mean.
I just hate your guts, right?
Yeah.
This happens all the time. For you new viewers, this is an ongoing feud. I have to keep them in line. You know, that's why we're well-armed on the set here.
I used to be the only co-host. Now you're
yeah.
co-host.
One false move and the gasoline will melt your styrofoam.
He's the only co-host that argues with his food.
You're co-host.
Cuckoo host.
Cocoa host.
Cuckoo papa. Cuckoo
Cocoa
papa.
Host.
Cuckoo
Cocoa
papa.
Oh
yeah,
boy, here they're starting again. Oh!
You miss me. You throw like a woman.
You saying cuckoo papa?
Cuckoo papa.
Cuckoo caca.
Oh,
cuckoo
yes,
papa.
That was a nice nap.
Cuckoo
I'm glad. Well, we'd like to thank you once again for enjoying
papa.
Dumpster Piece Theater, or at least I hope you attempted to enjoy it. Oh, yes, and we'd like to thank everybody that we met at the Poppy Festival
Poppy
over the
Festival.
Last weekend.
Yeah,
we'll show
right.
you some footage next week. We didn't get quite
next
around
week.
To editing it because it was too long and stuff. But
oh, and we got to watch Marathon's Other News next, right?
Oh, the Marathon's Other News is next. Damn.
Shopping spree.
Hey,
oh, yeah,
don't
reruns a shopping spree. No,
next
actually,
week
I think I'd rather watch Marathon
and
Other
us.
News than that. No.
And us. Hey, John.
Yeah, see, I'm complimentary
hey,
to a T tonight.
He doesn't care.
Hey, John.
He doesn't care.
Hey, John.
Yeah. What?
Hot 97.
Oh, yes, next week, next weekend, next Friday morning at 7 a.m.
Show.
We're going to be on Hot 97. That's myself, Stu, and Alfonso will be on Dino Robitaille's morning show.
97.7.
Hot 97 FM. So check
bye.
It out. We'll see you there, and we're on our way out.
7 o'clock in the morning. Be
7
there.
7 o'clock, yes. And
7
next
in the morning.
Friday, we're going to be showing
yeah.
you a movie.
Got a real singer
there. Scarred for Life is going to be at Desert Inn sometime.
That's a rock band.
Look at that geek dance.
Cool tunes.
We got titles this time.
Some moron.
Yeah, I did. And a bunch of other people who aren't
here right now.
The circle of dancing.
Hope this works
yeah.
or I'm going to run
and
into my car.
Don't do that home because you'll get glass all over your living room. Stay tuned for the Marathon's Man's Other News, whose opinion no longer expresses this station or anything else for that matter.
Brian and Paul, we're hungry. Yeah.
And we'll see whose jokes he stole this week. Oh, oh. Sorry.
Let's get out of here. Dumpsterpiece Theater is over. Marathon's News is coming up.
Tex,
let's get out of here.
Well, Tex, I don't know how fast the stage gets out of town, but if we can get out of shouting range of Marathon Man's Other News, I'm going to be a happy camper.
Hi, all Silver! Hi, all Scout!
Geez, I guess it's a good bowling, thing we are bowling, going to Marathon's bowling. Other News. This is a nasty weapon I've ever seen.
Bowling.
Yeah.
Three holes in
well, what's
ball.
All these extended shots? Where are the close-ups? Where's the dramatic impetus? Where's the... Oh, God,
where's
it's
the
Jeff's
movie?
Show. No! No! No!
Help me.
I'm excited about it.